Hello, everybody. I hope you can hear me well. Just a quick question. Can you see my slide? My slides?
Yes, but yes, not in presentation mode.
Not in presentation mode, yeah, true. So now you can see it, I guess. Can you see it?
Yes.
Can you see it? Yes, great. So basically, I will be talking about, well, is Bitcoin will be paving the way for blockchain applications. And the main point I will make in the presentation, Bitcoin's going to be really large and really large. And based on the success of Bitcoin, there will be many applications on the Bitcoin blockchain, but it also will fuel the development of many other blockchain developments. So as an introduction, I went to the ECB homepage and I looked at what's written on the homepage. And basically their goal, you know, is to maintain price stability. In order to maintain stability, they target and have an inflation target of 2%. Now, I think it's not stable if you have inflation of 2%. So the point is that that's bullshit. Big, big bullshit. Stability and 2% are bullshit. Not true. And the ECB tells us inflation is not a problem because wages and pensions on average rise even more than inflation. So people who work, workers, have no loss. So that's also bullshit. Why is that bullshit? Because inflation is much higher than officially reported. It's uneven. There's maybe low inflation on the goods you consume, on food, and there's significant asset inflation. but also wages don't increase equally. You know, lower wages maybe don't increase at all. But also, and I think that's really, really important to understand what's happening, what's doing inflation to the money you're not earning today, but you earned in the past. So let's look at this quick calculation. What about 2% inflation? So if there's 2% inflation, which is what the ECB is targeting, then you make one euro today, it's worth 1 euro, obviously. What happened to the euro you made 23 years ago in 1997? It's worth 63%. Now, it lost its value because of 2% inflation. So if the inflation is 3%, which it might be, then you lost half of it in 23 years. So inflation takes away a lot of the money you've earned in the past, and not just 2%, it takes away 50%. So if you look at this chart, the buying power of $1 over the last almost 50 years, it lost like 85% of its value. So inflation takes away a lot. So basically, obviously, money is a very, very bad store of value over the long term because of inflation. And I think this is a very, very important point. We think 2% inflation is not bad because it's just 2%, you don't notice and you don't feel it, and your wages also increase. But over the long term, a significant chunk of the money you earned is being taken away because of inflation. And basically, another view on inflation, and I think it's really important to think about it, to understand it, another view on inflation is, how do we make money? We convert our very, very scarce time into money because we work. So essentially, inflation is stealing our time. It's taking away the time we use to spend to earn money and to convert it to money. So inflation is stealing our time. And over the last 23 years, 37% of our time that we used to make money was taken away. Basically, essentially, inflation is stealing our life. And I think this point is really, really important to understand because it's much worse than most people view inflation and most people think of inflation. And you can really see that in a very interesting statistic on the next slide. Germany retail deposits over the last almost 20 years have been going up all the time. And the reason why this is bad, especially in Germany, people take their money and put it in their bank accounts, in the checking account, in the saving accounts. And there it's losing its value every day, a little bit, very little every day, but over time, a lot. So it's a huge problem. And I think because that's a huge problem, people are understanding more and more that fiat money is not a good store of value because it doesn't store value. The money I earned 23 years ago lost maybe 50% of its value. It's a very bad store of value. So therefore, we need a non-inflationary asset to store and transfer value. Of course, you know, Bitcoin, it's non-inflationary. And because it's non-inflationary, limited to 21 million minus the ones that are lost, it's non-inflationary, it's limited, there's a hard cap. And therefore, just therefore, it's a very good store of value. And obviously also gold, it's also very little inflationary. And I think there's many disadvantages of gold over Bitcoin. And one of them is we don't know how much gold there is. There could be much more. Just recently, I think in Siberia, there was a huge gold mine detected, and it can happen all the time, and gold mining on asteroids. So gold has many advantages, has a few disadvantages. So both of them are very good store value. And I think that point is really important. Fiat money is a bad store of value, period. It is a bad store of value. It's proven over time, over history. And actually, the current reserve banks, they have repeatedly made the point that they want to increase inflation, and they're increasing money supply continuously, and has been done in past centuries. It has been done all the time. All the fiat money systems are bad store of values. And by definition, Bitcoin and gold are good store values. And a very important counter argument: is Bitcoin a good store of value? Well, no, because of high volatility. And I think that argument is not valid. High volatility is positive. So the next slide, you see the Bitcoin price, it's the yellow chart, and the red chart is the volatility. So if you look at volatility, first of all, it's going down. And I claim that volatility will be very minimal once Bitcoin reaches a few hundred thousand euros per Bitcoin. So it will be continue to increase. But there's volatility spikes. So let's look at the volatility spikes. There is positive volatility spikes. Bitcoin is going up. So volatility is good because it needs to be volatile to go up. And then, of course, there's bad volatility spikes when Bitcoin is going down. So that's what we don't like. But on average, obviously, it's going up because the price is going up. So volatility is good in a way, and it's necessary for Bitcoin to go up. So will it go up? Where will it go? Of course, we don't know, but here's my opinion. It is a very good store of value if you can take the volatility. So another good store of value, obviously, I mentioned gold, valued at 10 trillion, and it's the thesis the vehicle was made. If gold achieves just the store of value if Bitcoin achieves the store of value that gold has achieved, then it could be worth $500,000 per Bitcoin. And that's just gold. Now, the main store of value that's being used are fiat currencies. So if Bitcoin grabs a little bit of gold, it grabs a little bit of the store value function, the very bad store value function of Bitcoin, it could go up even more. So of course, Bitcoin will not achieve that potential in one big jump. It will be many, many jumps up and down, but more up than down. And that's important to take. So what will that make? And I think that's really important to, that's my point. During that course of up and down, achieving the potential of store value Bitcoin today generates, did in the past and will in the future, generates and attracts top talent, it attracts capital, and it attracts, and that's maybe the most important point, tough people, tough girls and guys with strong hands who can take the volatility and solve the big problems. And while Bitcoin is achieving its potential as a store value and increasing in value, even volatile, increasing in value, there will be a very significant spillover effect to other blockchains. So and we've seen that in the ICO craze, you know, where Bitcoin went up 2017, the capital that was being attracted was spilling over to other blockchain solutions. And that will continue to happen in the future. So Bitcoin obviously is the most important blockchain application today. If you look at it was the first one, if you look at the market cap, $240 or $250 billion with a very, very high share. So it's the first and the biggest. And it has huge and increasing network effects, especially, you know, there's many network effects, but especially adoption from corporates. You've seen MicroStrategy, Michael Saylor, you know, putting a lot of money into Bitcoin. So the network effects, there's many network effects, especially the network effect from the investment side, from corporate, but also pension funds. And so many people will be buying Bitcoin. And maybe, and I think that point is very important, maybe the best blockchain, the truest blockchain implementation that we've seen so far. So you all know the blockchain property, the property of the Bitcoin blockchain. It's truly decentralized. It's not controlled by anyone. It's trustless, permissionless. It's open source. It's transparent. You all know this. And the point is, and I think it's really important, based on the property of the Bitcoin blockchain, there's many applications. And the first and biggest and huge application is and will be even more in the future just store of value, because fiat currencies are a very, very bad store of value, and they will be also in the future. So just that one application, store value, will be very big, but there will be more applications on the Bitcoin blockchain. Payment maybe with the Lightning Network, identity management, rights management, maybe applications that monetize the data that I freely give and receive, maybe Satoshis for my data, maybe social networks, maybe smart contracts. And the main point is, because the Bitcoin universe will be so big, just because of the store value application, there will be many, many more applications being built on top of the Bitcoin application, because it attracts talent, it attracts capital, and it attracts very, very smart and very, very tough girls and guys who can stand the volatility, who understand the technology. So that's the one big point. Because of bad store value of fiat, Bitcoin will be big. Because Bitcoin will be big, there will be many, many applications on top of the Bitcoin blockchain. Many. But the big question, will Bitcoin be the dominant standard, the only blockchain solution, just like Windows, the only operating system in the PC area? Well, is it really the only? No, there's also a little bit Apple Macintosh, Apple iOS. But there's other standards also. There's mainframe standard, there's Linux, there's Android, there's iOS on the phone, there's the Raspberry Pi. So as we've seen in the computer area, there have been dominant standards, dominant operating systems in certain segments of the computer industry, PC segment, smartphone segment, mainframe segment, but there are many systems. And likewise, there will be not just one operating system in the computer industry, but many, although there's a standard in the PC area, there's like a dual standard in the smartphone area. There's many operating systems in the PC area, and therefore there will be many blockchain solutions. Many blockchain solutions, maybe for smart contracts, there's a few candidates, decentralized networks. There will be solutions, as we've seen today, decentralized finance, restructuring of the financial industry, banking, insurance. There will be central blockchain for central bank money, and many more. So the point, I think, is Bitcoin will be big. Will be Bitcoin the dominant standard? No, I don't think so. There will be other blockchain solutions, and the energy, the capital, the talent, the intelligence from the Bitcoin universe will swap over more and more of course, also into other blockchain solutions. So that's the mechanism. Fiat money, bad store value. Bitcoin, very, very good store value. Bitcoin will be much, much bigger, at least 500,000 per Bitcoin in the next 10 years. And that will create many applications on the Bitcoin blockchain. And that will create a huge impact energy in other blockchain solutions. And I think the main trend, it's a very old slide, and this is my last slide, is innovation is developing exponentially. So it will be ever, ever faster. It will never stop. It will always accelerate. And the exponential innovation in technology, here you see the microprocessors on the chips on the microprocessor, Moore's law. So and there's many exponential trends in innovation. And I think that exponential innovation in the whole blockchain universe will very, very quickly create amazing new applications. And the capital will be there, the talent will be there, the smartness will be there, the toughness will be there. And my perspective is very, very positive. And I thank the central banks very much for the bad store value, because that creates all that energy in the Bitcoin and blockchain universe. Thank you very much. This is the very last slide. Here are my contact data. Please reach out. And here you see the Bitcoin performance data monthly. We're having a good month. October has been green very often in the past, and November. So I'm very bullish for this year. We will see all-time high this year. That's my forecast. And we will see much higher figures next year. Thank you very much.